Well, good morning, Mount Olive.
Good morning.
Sometimes it takes me a little bit longer to get going. Well, when you have to put three things around your ears, you know, a headset and glasses and a mask, I always get tangled up. And it's just more trouble than it's worth sometimes from there. It's good to see you this morning. I'm glad you're here. And we're looking forward to a time to worship. If you're a guest with us today, we're really glad that you're here. And trust that you're going to be blessed from the time that we spend lifting up the Lord in praise this morning. And so we're going to hear His word. We're going to sing. We're going to pray together and ask God to send His Holy Spirit to fill this room this morning. So Jason, let's go ahead and worship.
Well, good morning, church. I hope you're glad to be here this morning. I know that we are. Let's stand if you're able, and let's sing some songs together this morning.
And these are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in your word. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Now let's pray together this morning. Dear Lord, we love You. We thank You for this time we get to come together and worship through singing, through the praising of Your name, through giving, through the preaching of Your word, through everything that we say and do this morning. I pray that You will be honored and glorified. It's in Your holy name that we pray. Amen. Let's continue to worship as we sing this together.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory increased. beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. He didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. And you have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. And great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Join with all nations. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, the peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Let's be seated this morning as Wally comes.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, there are many things that we need to pray for. Most of those you know about, but let me just remind you of a couple. Thank you for all your prayers of Kathy for this past week and the process that she has gone through. I just ask that you keep her in your prayers as we adapt to a new normal for us. We're thankful that much that we know that we have your prayers. I want to continue to pray for Velma and Libby and the Tillman family and the passing of their brother. And we just we had a wonderful service, I think, yesterday, and a family together remembering who he was to them. So keep them in prayer as they adjust to this loss as well. This morning, as part of our prayer time, we're also going to dedicate our Christmas child boxes. I think everybody's already brought them up front from there. If you had it, and you can run it down here real quickly if you want to from that line. We don't want to leave anybody else out. Well, you can walk, you don't have to run, but you know. It's always a special time when we can celebrate and give thanksgiving for all that has been done to put these boxes together and pray for those that are going to receive them so that they might receive the blessing that we desire for them and might come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior through that time. I think that's all of them from there. Thank you, Kamiko. So as I go to prayer this morning, I'm going to ask you, as I usually do, if you're able and willing, if you will go to your knees with me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you this morning with a heart of thanksgiving because we have so much to be thankful for. We know this has been one crazy year and one that we probably will not be too sad to see go away. But we know, Lord, that you have a plan and you're working that plan out in each of our lives. And doesn't anything happen that you don't know about and you're not aware of and that you're not working out your plan. So we thank you, Lord, for the blessings that we have even in the midst of pandemics and other struggles because we are your children. We have the blessing of knowing you as Lord and Savior and bearing that promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you are here this morning that we can pray and you've heard the things that we've mentioned this morning specifically that we need to pray about. Those that have needs, and we know, Father, there are many more within our community and those around us that are going through struggles right now and challenges. And Lord, we know, though, that your will is perfect, so we surrender our will to you because you know what each person needs best meet that need. And we just recognize the fact, God, that you are our creator and you're the giver of all good things. We thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do and how you're going to be praised and blessed for it. And Lord, as we come here this morning, this very special day, when we look at each one of these little boxes, which we feel are filled with so many insignificant things as far as we're concerned in the world that we live in. We know that before long, these will be in the hands of children throughout the world. Children who will learn about you through what's in these boxes. They'll learn and be able to come to a knowledge of you through the work of so many people. And so, Father, we just ask your blessings upon each one of these boxes, not only in the box and the little things and the people who have prepared it, but for the ones that are going to receive them. That, Lord, that you will be able to touch their hearts through the workers around them. And through these simple acts of kindness and generosity, that they can come to know you as Lord and Savior. Because, Father, there is no better way than through the hearts of children. And we thank you, Father, for what you're going to do with each one of these. We thank you for all who've worked so diligently in putting them together, those that are preparing them to be shipped, and the organizations that take care of that. And Lord, we just pray that you will receive the glory for it, and you alone. And Father, as we look at your word this morning, I pray that you might open scriptures to us in a way maybe we've never seen them before, that we might have understanding that maybe we had not had before, that you would reveal more of yourself in everything that we do. Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, that you loved us first, that you cared for us so much to send Jesus to pay a price we could not pay, to have a gift that we could not purchase on our own. And we just thank you, Lord, for all you are and all you do. Send your Holy Spirit to fill this building, every heart and every mind, that we might give you glory through it all. And we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I could hear that stack growing. We're going to be looking in the book of Mark this morning, chapter 14. We're going to be looking at different verses throughout this. So if you want to go ahead and turn to that in your Bibles. I want to ask you a hard question this morning, and one that you probably don't want to answer. Come on, guys, you got it. You got it. Yeah, that looks better on that side over there, too. Thank you. Are you embarrassed of Jesus? Are you embarrassed of Jesus? You know, we all love Jesus. We love him a lot when it doesn't cost us anything. It's easy to love when there's no pressure. But if you look at this story of Peter, as the cost of his love got larger, he began to back away from that relationship with Christ, or at least his willingness to profess it. And as for our lives, I believe that we find out at times that when the cost or the pressure rises, so does the likelihood that we might become embarrassed of him. I mean, what is the cost? Well, if you look at the picture of Peter in these verses here in chapter 14, in the beginning of verse 66, we read, while Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by, and when she saw Peter warming him, she looked closely at him, said, "You also were with that Nazarene Jesus," she said. But he denied it. "I don't know or understand what you're talking about," he said, and went out into the entryway. And then the servant girl saw him there, and she said again to those standing around, "This fellow is one of them." And again he denied it. After a little while, those standing near to Peter said, "Surely you're one of them, for you're a Galilean." And he began to call down curses, and he swore to them, "I don't know this man that you're talking about." Peter was afraid of physical danger, but for us that would probably not be the issue. But it might mean that we might lose a job. It might mean that we might harm a relationship with someone else. Or we might have financial issues. Or we might lose social standing. Or we might be embarrassed with our friends if we allow that relationship to take precedence. I mean, you look at the spike in Peter's life, how quickly it happened. You know, it started off, and if you go back into verse 27, of that same book, it says, when Jesus was talking to him, he says, you will all fall away. And Jesus said, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I've risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. But Peter declared, even if I'll fall away, I will not. You know, he declared that he would not fall away. He would not be embarrassed of Jesus, which was easy for him to do because he was surrounded by disciples and there was no enemy in sight. But you go a few verses past that in verse 50, and when it got right down to it, they all fled. They didn't deny him, but they all fled. And so then the scripture that we read, it only took one accuser, and he vaguely denied that he knew Jesus, and then he walked away. So the question I want you to think about this morning is, when does serving Jesus become too expensive for you? When does the cost become too high for you to serve Christ? I want us, you know, you might say to me, well Wally, I've never done anything like Peter. I've never yelled, I don't know the man. You know, I've never done that. And that's probably true, at least I hope it is. But there are other ways that we have decided that standing for Jesus wasn't worth the cost. I want to show you five examples this morning, or ask you about five examples this morning, starting from the least threatening to the greatest threatening, and see just exactly where your cost level is as far as it's concerned. The first one is this: do I acknowledge proudly and publicly that I'm a Christian? Do I acknowledge publicly and privately that I'm a Christian? Romans 1:16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it's the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew and then the Gentile. I'm afraid in the world that we live in today, there's too many of us that think there's such a thing as private faith. You know, we think our faith is just between us and God. It's nobody else's business, and it's nobody else's nothing that they should worry about. But I can't, in searching through Scripture, I can't seem to find any reference to private faith, you know, because I believe when we have a right relationship with Christ, there's no way in the world it's going to stay private. It can't. But, you know, I think we keep it private in subtle ways. Maybe we never bring up anything about the Bible or truth in our conversations. Maybe we never mention going to church. Maybe we never mention, you know, praying for someone. You know, maybe we just things we leave out more than what we add in. You know, that the aspects of our life that mean something to us will find their way into our conversation. For example, okay, you know that I like to garden. You know that for many years I was a firefighter and a first responder. You know that I like to hunt and fish. Some of you know that I played in a rock band when I was in high school. Some of you are shocked at this point in time. But these things come up in my conversations with you, you know, probably way more times than you wish they would, you know, from there. But those are things in my life that were important to me. And because they were important to me, then it becomes easy for me to relate them to you and to bring them into conversations because of their importance. But if we say Jesus is important to us, if we say that he means a lot to us, but he never comes up in our conversation, then what does that really say about how important our faith is to us? If someone went around to your friends and your neighbors and asked, is so-and-so a Christian? Would the answer be yes? Would they know? Or would the answer be absolutely? You know, if directly asked, we would say that we are, but that's not what I mean. I mean, sometimes we seem to compare our faith to a driver's license. You know, I don't know about you, but it seems like a lot of times when I go into the drugstore or to some other place and they want to see my driver's license, you know, like when you're buying your antihistamines and stuff like that, you know, and my wallet's old, you know, and my driver's license, it takes me a few minutes to pry this thing out of the hole, you know, from there, and because I don't take it out very often. And they won't look at it, you know, in the wallet. They got to hold it, you know, from there. Why, I don't know. They never look at the back of it, so what difference does it make? But I don't take it out. So if you want to see, I don't walk around like this with my driver's license on my shirt. So if you want to see my driver's license, you got to ask for it. And see, I think that's the thing about some of us having our relationship with Christ. We'll tell you about it, but you got to ask for it. It's not going to be obvious to you. I'll take it out and show it to you. But Romans 1:8 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Are you? See, sometimes we forget how simple it would be to bring Christ into the conversation. We were in the doctor's office multiple times this past week. And the young lady who is the doctor's tech, you're going to get a chance to meet her. Because it turns out she lives in Welborn. And so I'm in Gainesville, she lives in Welborn, and I'm saying, And she says, I asked her where she lives in Welborn. She told me. And she said, I said, we live in Welborn too. And she said, no, I didn't know that. And I said, yeah. I said, I'm the pastor of Mount Olive Baptist Church. And she says, I know where that is. She said, I've been looking for a place to go to church since we settled back down in there. I said, the door is always open. We'd love to have you come. And she says, she's coming. And her daughter, came easily into the conversation when I didn't even expect it to, from there. And we began to talk about spiritual things during that time. I'm looking forward to seeing her when she comes in. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Are you? Are we ashamed of the gospel? The second instance is, in worship, do I focus on what other people think? John 4:24 says, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. So when we're worshiping, we're supposed to be giving glory and honor to God and to Jesus Christ. But I wonder sometimes if we're more concerned about what the person sitting beside us is thinking about us. I mean, I know you're always felt led to say amen, so I know the person sitting beside you is keeping you from doing that. Or at least must be, because I don't hear it very often. Yeah, thank you. Give her a sucker right there. But I mean, we might be worried about that person sitting beside us, what they're saying and what they're thinking. We might feel that we should go forward at the end of the service. We might feel the conviction to ask for prayer or to pray, through a situation. But we don't do it because we're worried that the person sitting down the pew from us is saying, well, what have they done that they got to go down to the front for? Might have that approach to it. We might feel like we want to raise our hands when we praise, when we're singing. The words really have gotten to us and hit home to our hearts. And we want to do that, but we don't want anybody to think we're a fanatic or that we're crazy. I mean, some of our folks don't worry about that very much, do they? Yeah, that's there. Give her another sucker, from there. But, sometimes we worry more about it. We're moved by the message, and maybe we get emotional about what we hear from God's word, but we won't let the tears fall because we're too embarrassed, worrying about what the person sitting beside us is thinking. What's the common thread to all these things? Pride. We're worried about what somebody else is going to think about us from there, rather than what God's thinking about us. Rather than what Jesus thinks about us. Jesus called us to praise and honor him. Of course, we shouldn't force worship. We shouldn't make it happen. I mean, worship should not be a performance or an act for us. But when the Spirit moves us, we cannot be too embarrassed to let it show. The odd or sad thing about this type of embarrassment is where it occurs? In the least threatening atmosphere that we should ever be in, which is within the family of God. This is the one place that we should be able to feel and do what the Holy Spirit leads us to do. But sometimes we feel more oppressed there than any others. And if we're embarrassed of Jesus in this very low threat environment, what's the likelihood that we're going to be proud of our faith when we're out in the open and out in the world? The third situation is this. In public, do I stand for the publicly acceptable parts of the gospel? Let me ask you this. Matthew 5:29 says, if your right eye causes you to sin, then gouge it out and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. You know, there are parts of our Christian beliefs that everyone agrees are pretty great. You know, we know that God is love. We know that we're supposed to love our neighbor. We know that God is going to forgive us if we ask forgiveness from our sins. You know, those are the what I call the warm and fuzzy aspects of Christian faith. I mean, even people who are not Christian would embrace these and not have a problem with them. But then there's those other parts. Those other parts that everyone's not so crazy about, such as there's a place called hell. God wants you to get rid of sin in your life. Sex outside of marriage is wrong. Those are things that not everyone likes, and some people find offensive. So they're less likely to be publicly embraced by anyone. But when you stand on the truth, when you claim to stand on the truth of God's word, do you only want to stand on those warm and fuzzy parts that everybody agrees with? Or are you willing to stand on the hard parts? Are you willing to stand when a subject comes up in a discussion that's not one of these, whether you're at work or whether you're among friends, that touches on one of these less warm and fuzzy places? Do you just be silent? Do you just not say anything? Are you embarrassed of what Jesus has said isn't true on that particular issue? Or are we wanting more to please man than God? The fourth picture is this. In one of my relationships, will I speak the truth even if it might hurt that friendship? Ephesians 4:15 said, instead of speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. Speaking the truth in love. One of the most misused phrases in the English language. Because we use it to cover a multitude of sins, don't we? You know, if we want to criticize somebody or we want to challenge somebody, you know, we say, well, we're speaking the truth in love, you know. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't challenge somebody when they're in error or when they're doing something's wrong. But we genuinely need to speak the truth in love. We need to speak it because Jesus instructed us to. He instructed us to speak the truth in love. Now, we have to be discerning when God is leading us into something like this, because front confrontation can hurt the one that we love. But the real issue is not whether or not you want to hurt the feelings of someone else. The real issues are that, first, you don't like confrontation. Secondly, we don't want anybody to be mad at us. We don't like anybody being mad at us. Sometimes this sort of thing can be handled in a very offensive way. Or perhaps the biggest one is we're embarrassed to do what Jesus wants us to do. That one hurt. We are embarrassed to do what Jesus tells us to do. I just don't want to stand in obedience to Christ when it gets uncomfortable. There are times when confronting someone over an issue can be received poorly and hurt their friendship, but if we choose to ignore the command of Jesus and the leading of the Spirit to deal with the issue, is to put Jesus second. Jesus second. We need to be more concerned about what Jesus thinks than what anybody else thinks. So lastly, would I tell someone how to be saved? Would I go into that area? John 3 says this, in reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he's born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he's born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How often do we witness to someone and point them towards Christ? When was the last time you had a chance to witness to someone? I think most statistics will tell us that the average Christian may actually participate in winning one person to Christ in their lifetime. One person to Christ. Is it because we're ashamed of the gospel? Or is it because we don't have the spiritual wisdom to understand when we have the opportunity? I hope that's probably the biggest problem. I hope that's what it is. We need to pray every day that God will give us the opportunity to share our faith, but even more so, that He will give us the wisdom to recognize it when it happens. Because it doesn't always happen with somebody walking up to you and saying, "Tell me about Jesus." It may come in through another door. But we need the wisdom to understand it when it comes, that we have the opportunity, because we want to be able to share Jesus any opportunity we have. It's scary to ask somebody if they know Jesus. They may react negatively. They may react angrily. They may ask questions that you don't know the answer to, but someone could mock your belief because of it. We, you know, are in the process of beginning our study of other religions and cults in our Sunday night services. And I guarantee you that if you're willing to engage someone who is involved in one of these groups, you're going to be mocked. You're going to be challenged. You're going to be not loved, maybe I'll put it that way. But that's what God wants us to do. But too often, I think we just avoid it. We just avoid it. We allow the cover to go across our eyes. So we, even if there's an open door, we tend to walk around it rather than through it. So in the end, what it means that we're embarrassed of Jesus and the salvation He offers. We'll tell somebody about this great new book that we're reading, or this fancy restaurant that we've enjoyed, or what is our favorite television show. We'll tell them about that, but we won't talk about what Jesus can do for them. We won't talk about it. So what is your level of comfort? Can you overcome the escalating pressure that comes when you serve the Lord? Because I promise you, the pressure is not going to get less. The more that you speak Jesus, the more challenges that you're going to get. And the world we live in today, that's going to grow in every day. But we need to decide that, that we're going to put our Jesus t-shirt on. You know, we're going to put our stickers on the back of our cars, and we're going to live like we belong to the Lord. And we're going to seize every opportunity to tell anyone in any way what Jesus means to us. Let's look at Peter again. In Mark 14, it says, she saw Peter coming, warming himself. She says, "You were with that Nazarene." What did he say? "I don't know, understand what you're talking about." So one girl challenged him and he walked away. Secondly, in Mark 14, 69, the servant girl saw him there and said, "This fellow's one of them." Again, he denied it. It was the same girl, but he vaguely denies it again, but doesn't walk away. And then a few verses later, those standing near to Peter said, "Surely you're one of them, for you're a Galilean." And what did he do? He began to call down curses upon himself and others. He swore to them, "I don't know this man that you're talking about." So now he boldly and profanely denies. See, our denial of Christ is not always a Peter moment. It's not always a big deal. It's not always something that we even maybe recognize at the time, but sometimes those are relatively quiet moments with relatively small consequences. But we have to be on our toes, because we never will know when the temptation can come. Think about this. Elijah was bold in confronting 850 of Baal's prophets. He was bold when that time came, and then he ran and hid from one woman. See, we never know what the circumstances are going to be. Are you a child of God, or are you a second cousin twice removed? How do we live our lives? Are we? And I'm not saying that we, as Christians, we become arrogant. No more than anything else, we should become humble. We should become humble and proud of our relationship with Christ, because we didn't do anything to earn it. It is through the grace of God that we have that blessing and that salvation. And we should be proud that God sacrificed for us so that we might be able to be with him for all of eternity. If you're a child of God, be proud of it. Don't let your testimony in this world be, do I know him? Well, yeah, kind of, sort of, in a distant relationship, but I kind of know him. It's like growing up in my family. We had, my mama's family was the Farnells from Day. My dad's family were the Weavers from Cross City. And the families probably got too familiar because I have two sets of what they call double first cousins, because mama's brothers married daddy's sisters and vice versa. And we decided over the years with the family reunions would be together. The two families, they were so intertwined, you know, that they would be together. So it would be interesting. We get together, haven't done it in years, but there'd be, you know, 70, 80 people there. Most of them, I had no clue who they were, even though supposedly they were my blood relatives, but I had no clue who they were. I knew who my double first cousins were, but other than that, we didn't go very far along that line. And so I think sometimes we have that kind of distant relationship with Christ. We're part of the family of God, but if Jesus was to walk in the room, somebody had to point him out to us. Somebody had to point him out to us from there. Should that be your testimony, or should it be, no, I'm a child of God. I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm proud of having him in my life. Do y'all like Charlie Brown, the cartoon series over the years? My favorite character was Pigpen. Y'all remember Pigpen? He was always dirty. And everywhere he went, this cloud followed him. It's just kind of like he was a big dustpan going everywhere he went. But everywhere he went, he left a trail. Everywhere he went, he filled the air with dust and dirt from his body because he didn't bathe. That's what it should be as us, as Christians. Not dirt and dust, but Jesus. Everywhere we go. When we go into a room, it should change the attitude of the room. It should change the smell of the room, so to speak. You know, one of the things, when I became a volunteer fireman years ago, you know, and started out working with what I call my 14 heathens, and you were part of the station that we served, the chief several years later made this remark. He said, you know, when you became a member of this fire department, the conversation changed. The language, they knew I was a pastor. The language changed. The actions changed. The tempers changed. Now, that wasn't because of me, but it was because of the presence of Christ there. And see, we should have that influence everywhere we go. And we should be willing to pay whatever price it is so that the world we know might come to know the Jesus we know. So my challenge to you this morning is to decide, when does serving Jesus become too expensive for you? And I hope as you look at God's word and you pray about it, you can come to the conclusion is that it will never get too expensive for me. Because it's only through my relationship with Jesus that I have life, and I have life eternally. And I want everybody I come in contact with to have it too. Because after all, once we're saved, that's our purpose here, is to spread it wherever we go. Be a spiritual pigpen. Spread it wherever you go. And for those of you this morning who know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I pray that you will come to that point of saying, there is no price too high for me to serve Jesus. Nothing that I will not do to share him with the world. And if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, today is your day of decision. You say, well, I'm not ready to make that decision. You have just made a decision. You either say yes or no to Christ every time he calls you. So today is your day of decision. Don't make the wrong one. Come to light. Come to health. Come to the saving grace of Jesus Christ before you leave here today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word, because it's through your word that we learn all about you. At the same time, we learn about ourselves. And sometimes the exposure is not pretty, but it helps us to grow to become more like you want us to be. So today, we want to be proud We want to be proud because you chose us, sent Jesus to save us, so that we might be able to live with you forever. But that pride should lead us to want to share that gift with everyone we come in contact with. In a world that is lost and has lost its way, let us be that light, Father. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jason?
Let's stand. Let's sing this together.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain.
So glad you were here this morning. I hope that you have a great afternoon, and I hope this week that you don't forget where your Thanksgiving belongs, not just on the table, but in your heart towards God and all that He has given to you and blessed you over the years. Let me remind those of you who join me on Wednesday night for a Zoom meeting, we will not be meeting this Wednesday night. So I want you to enjoy times with your family and friends. Only a couple of weeks left to go before our tailgate party on the 6th. That's right, the 6th, right?
Yeah, so actually our tailgate is going to start at what time did you say? 6? 5? 5:30.
Whenever we get here.
I'll be here all day. So we actually have all of the times or all of the slots that I created on the sign-up sheet for the talent show. They're all filled. But if you just have something on your heart that you want to, well, I'm going to keep adding slots and we'll keep signing people up. We'll just be here all night. So
y'all have been saved then with me and Damon doing a duet, from there.
It's still on.
We've been trying to debate exactly what we were going to sing. We were thinking about maybe doing the Village People's YMCA, from there. something real spiritual like that, for a good time together. We're going to have a great time that night at the fellowship all around the playground. We're going to dedicate our new playground space to the glory of God and just have a time for once again as a family to get together. Of course, we're going to take care of ourselves and socially distance and mask up and do what we need to do so that we stay safe and that we stay well. But I hope you have a great week. I hope you will join us back here tonight. We'll begin by looking at Jehovah Witnesses tonight from there. That'll be the first of the ones we'll look at. So we've had a good crowd each Sunday night, and I hope you'll come and join us tonight as we get together for that. We're pleased this morning to have Andy and Ramona Jordan with us today. Andy is the driving missional force behind our association. He's been a blessing to us and all that he has accomplished here, and I'm looking forward to what God is going to do through him and through the days to come. Because I believe that God has great things for our association and the things that we're going to do. So, Andy, I would ask you if you would close us in prayer before Jason leads us in our final song.
Amen. As we sing this morning and are dismissed, make sure you walk by the information desk and see if there's somewhere that you'd like to serve. And I just wanted to make known, Sunday nights, it's been requested that we record it for anyone that's not able to come to the study on the different religions or beliefs and cults that we're going to be studying. So that is going to be available online, just so everybody knows. So let's sing this together and let's be dismissed this morning.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain and cleansed by His blood. Joint heirs with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family.
This morning, thank you.